Okay, we're going to get started with non-agenda item public testimony. We've got a large number of speakers on non-agenda item testimony, and so we want to limit this to 2 minutes. We also are going to try to get through as many of the non-agenda speakers as we can before we start the meeting, but I don't think we're going to get through all of you. So if you're not called prior to the start of the meeting, and you want to speak, please stay until after we complete the meeting, and then we'll have more non-agenda item testimony at that point. So let's start with Julieta Juarez, Lupe Rios, Charlotte Marquez, and Vicky Toscano.
Good evening. I will be interpreting for this mother.
Okay.
Sorry, there will be another parent coming up first.
Good afternoon. My name is Vicky Toscano, fourth grade teacher at Promise Charter School. I'm joined by concerned parents and teachers from Promise and Tubman Charter Schools to tell you about the serious problems happening at our schools. It was in 2004 that I was hired as a teacher at Promise. Within my first week, all teachers had offered their resources, their time, and their support. I quickly fell in love with the community at Promise. We didn't have a high-tech facility nor fancy resources, but we had trust, respect, and a collaborative culture at our school. For 6 years, we had collaborative meetings and discussions about our students' needs, and we held each other accountable. When we had staff meetings, all teachers had an opportunity to speak and collaboratively make decisions in the best interests of our students. All parents were welcomed onto our campus and encouraged to be part of the school. When our students had academic difficulties, we worked as a group to come up with solutions. These years of hard work and dedication from students, parents, and teachers resulted in our API breaking 800 last year. However, since June of 2010, when Kevin LaChapelle and Jose Orozco orchestrated a takeover of our school, that spirit of collaboration has been taken from us. Now Promise is a school where one of our best-loved teachers was fired, where all returning teachers will have to reapply, re-interview, and sign a statement of commitment to the school's core values we have never even seen or approved, where there are irregularities about enrollment and legal procedures that we are afraid to challenge, and where dedicated teachers are humiliated with unfounded rumors of incompetence from the principal supporters. We bring this to you as a leap of faith, as in the past we haven't received much support from the district. However, we cannot stand by and watch our parents and students be disenfranchised, humiliated, and threatened any longer. These issues pose a severe and imminent threat to the health and safety of our students. On behalf of teachers and parents at Promise, we ask that you immediately launch a thorough and expedited investigation of the issues we have brought to your attention, seek and implement immediate remedies to these violations, provide direct oversight of our governing board by appointing a member to represent San Diego Unified as is permitted by the law, and finally, we ask that you closely monitor our school to ensure that there is no retaliation against any member of our community who has stepped forward to bring these issues to your attention. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mi nombre es Julieta Juárez. Tengo en la escuela Promise Charter más de 8 años y 2 de mis hijos han salido de Promise. Ahora tengo una hija en cuarto y otra en séptimo. Escogí Promise Charter porque hasta hace poco era la escuela ideal para educar a mis hijos.
My name is Julieta Juarez, and at Promise Charter School I have been for more than 8 years. Two of my children came out of Promise, and now I have a daughter in fourth grade and a nephew in seventh grade. I chose Promise because until recently it was the ideal school for my children.
El lema de la escuela era impulsar a la comunidad a través de la educación y la colaboración de padres, estudiantes y personal. Nuestros hijos no eran un número más, sino personas. La comunicación entre padres y maestros hacía efectivo el aprovechamiento de nuestros hijos. Se valoraba la diversidad cultural y en los diversos comités escolares se abogaba y se compartían las sugerencias de los maestros y de los padres a través de los representantes elegidos.
The school motto was to motivate the community through education and collaboration between parents, students, and staff. Our children were not just one more number, but they were people. The communication between parents and teachers made possible the achievement of our students, of our children. Cultural diversity was valued in the different committees, school committees, and suggestions were shared from the teachers and the parents through all of the elected representatives.
Ahora todo esto ha cambiado. Como miembro que soy del comité consultivo, se me ha pedido que ya no esté en ese comité por motivos que no son ciertos.
And now everything has changed. As a member of the school site council, I have been told that I can no longer form a part of that committee for reasons which are untrue.
Debido a varias preguntas sin respuestas, me viene la necesidad de protestar fuera del plantel, y después de eso Orozco le preguntaba a mi hija cuándo y a qué horas haría mi siguiente protesta.
Due to various questions which went unanswered, I saw the need to protest outside the school. And after that, Orozco would ask my daughter when and at what time my next protest would be.
En una junta de la mesa directiva, el señor Kevin LaChapelle me llamó a mí y a otros padres activistas y nos intimidó señalándonos con el dedo, diciendo que él sabía quién era cada uno de nosotros, que no teníamos credibilidad y que si no nos parecía, que sacáramos a nuestros hijos de Promise. Y en otra ocasión me dijo que los padres ya no acudían a las juntas porque yo los intimidaba con mis protestas. A este punto, mi hija siente temor de que el director tome represalias contra ella, así como lo hizo con más de 25 estudiantes que dejaron Promise por los mismos motivos.
At one of the board meetings, Mr. Kevin LaChapelle called me and other activist parents in, and he intimidating us, telling us with pointing at us with his finger, saying that he knew who each and every one of us were, and that we had no credibility, and if we didn't like it, we could take our children out of Promise. On another occasion, he told me that the parents were no longer attending the meetings because I intimidated them with my protests. At this point, my daughter feels has a lot of fear that the principal will take actions against her, just as he did against more than 25 other students who left Promise because of the same reasons.
Es triste ver cómo nuestra escuela ya no es la misma y no podemos hacer lo necesario para que nuestros hijos vuelvan a tener alegría y el deseo de superación que tenía antes.
It's sad to see how our school is not the same, and that we cannot do anything what is necessary to see that our children will be happy again and to have the desire to better themselves the way they did before.
Pedimos a los representantes de esta mesa directiva una investigación y que se remedien las violaciones. También pedimos la voz y para maestros y padres que teníamos antes, y que el distrito supervise y monitoree las actividades de la mesa directiva a través de un representante para evitar represalias.
We ask that the representation and the voice that the parents and the teachers had before, that the district supervise and monitor the activities of the board at the school through a representative so that we can avoid any actions against us. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Guadalupe Rivas. I haven't been part of Promise for 6 years as a parent, as a member of board of directors, as a PTO president, as a helper in the library. I did this because I like the family environment, the dedication of the teachers, and how much learning took place at Promise. And I wasn't the only one. Many parents felt the same. We used to participate in all the decisions and events affecting our children. But this year, the board led by Kevin LaChapelle and the principal Jose Orozco changed completely. Starting during the summer vacations, parents no longer had representation on the board like we used to. In August, our group of parents met with principal and then with the board to ask what was going on. Instead of answering us questions, they treated us if we were ignorant. They called the police on us, they threatened us with a lawsuit, and keep us off the campus, even to pick up our kindergartens. But worst of all, for me as a parent, the principal harassed and intimidated my daughter and the children of other parents involved. He called them into the office alone and asked them about the parents' activities and meetings. He threatened them that if they didn't tell them what it happened, receive their awards for getting proficient or advanced on the CSTs. He singled them out in front of their class and bullied them over the new uniform policy. He held them in detention in the sun for a whole lunch period and left them only 5 minutes to eat. For all these reasons, I decided to pull my children from Promise, as did many others. I feel particularly upset that my other two kids will not have the opportunity to get the great education that my eighth grader was receiving at Promise before this year. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Charlotte Marquez, and I'm a student at Promise Charter School since I was in sixth grade. And when I started, I did not have the best grades, but I was never treated differently. In Promise, there was always trust and family. So the first year Mr. Orozco was introduced as principal, he played us all as a person you can trust. But indeed, that was a lie. This is a year where all the problems emerge into the second or third month of the year. Mr. Orozco came up with a harsh plan to make us listen to him. So for lunch, which we have an hour, he took us to the abandoned side of the school where no one was able to see and made us stand in a straight line and we were not able to move. And he gave us a little point of time to eat, but this all stopped when the school had installed cameras. He chose to pick on eighth grade out of all grades. For example, on a festival we did not want to participate, Mr. Orozco and Mrs. Torres harassed us to the point we gave in. The consequences of not participating was that we were not allowed to sell or sell off our on-school grounds using the Promise Charter name. Mr. Orozco called it a privilege, and today we are not fundraising because of PTO. Many students began to rebel Mr. Orozco's rules because he always threatened us. Many parents came to see why we were always getting in trouble, but as always, Mr. Orozco had behaved differently. But what made things worse is that Mr. Orozco was spying on our Facebooks, and plus he was always threatening us to get expelled or suspended. But in my case, I would get the police called on me. Out of many comments he's made at me, once he told me that he did not have time for students like me, and I have a 3.5 GPA, which made no sense. Mr. Orozco gave us papers to run for ASB, and he told me I did not qualify because of my attitude, which was not one of the qualifications on the form. My parents and some parents came to complain to Mr. Orozco, and so he decided to step off, and PTO stepped on. Mr. Orozco allowed PTO to come interrupt our classes and pull out students frequently, and still wondered why our grades were dropping when we were never to be found in class because of himself and PTO. Mr. Orozco continued to make changes to single all students and blame everything on the eighth grade. And he always questioned us why we did not want to work with PTO, and he always assumed that the teachers were brainwashing us. And it's hard to go to school when Mr. Orozco is always calling the class to pull out students and single them out in front of everybody. And it's hard when the new teachers come in to tell Mr. Orozco and PTO are always making faces at us and putting pressure on us because of their problems that we have no part in.
Okay, we'll have to wrap up. Thanks, Charlotte. Okay. Okay, I know that this is a non-agenda item, but if I could ask the superintendent to look into, these are some serious issues that are being raised, and I think we do need to do an investigation, and I think we need to make sure that we're talking to everybody we need to talk to, but that the people who talk to us have some protection, that they're not going to be intimidated or retaliated against. All right.
We'll immediately go ahead. And I'd also like to echo Mr. President Barrera's remarks. As a teacher in a school, I think it's really important that there's a positive, collaborative environment so that all children can get a better education. I think it's important that we try to look into this.
All right. Thanks. Yes, Mr.
To the Promise parents, I know where you started at, and I know how you transitioned and how hard you've worked to get your school to where it is. This is sad that this is occurring on your campus, because I know all of the wonderful work that has happened from day one when you were at Bethel to moving to finding a site. And again, I want to thank the parents and Seth that's here tonight speaking up, because that's what made your school great to start with. And you was a school that was built on collaboration with the community, and that's why it has been a success. And so certainly, and I got all the information too that you sent me, so thank you very much. Yeah. Background.
Okay, now I'd like to call up Angelica Quiros, Anne Marie Klin, Shivani Burroughs Goodwill, and Nicole Bell.
Hello, my name is Angelica Quiroz, and I have two kids, an eighth grader and a third grader at Harriet Tubman Charter Village School. I have been a proud member of Tubman community for 7 years. For many years, our school has been placed where teachers and parents were able to work together to help our kids learn. Parents and teachers had say in our boards, in our classrooms also. Over the past year, the principal and her handpicked board have taken more and more control, and the teachers and parents have had less and less to say. We did not have the problems we have now, and we have come together to protect our school. Decisions are now made without talking to parents and teachers. Good teachers are fired because the principal does not respect them. These violations are charter and a law, I believe. Schedules, classrooms, and grades are completely changed around with no saying from parents, students, or teachers. Friends of the principals are added to our board without no elections or through parents and teacher representation. Outsiders are brought onto our board so they can change our school as they have changed Promise Charter School, as you heard. I have met with the parents, with the teachers and parents at Promise Charter School, and cannot believe their board president is now on our board with no say from us or the teachers. We must not allow parents, teachers, and even students to be targeted or harassed because they disagree with the direction of a school. Since our board has ignored our request for honest decision-making and is not acting on behalf of our school community, we ask that you demand that the Tubman board and administration follow our charter and the law. We want to change our school leadership and to make sure that the people like Kevin LaChapelle do not take our school down the direction he has taken Promise Charter School. We want our school to be back because we know how great it can be. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Anne-Marie Klin. I hold two credentials, one multiple subject K-8 and a special ed credential K-12. I also have a master's in special ed. I've been working for Tubman for 2 years. I love teaching, I love Tubman, and I love being an employee in Santa Unified. Harry Tubman once said, "I have never ran my train off the tracks and I have never lost a passenger." Unfortunately, this cannot be said for Tubman Charter. This grade school has run off the tracks. With Tubman Charter Board being biased, teachers have no say in everyday school decisions. There are no real representation of teachers in our board. Money has been spent on lawyers and lawsuits and not on school supplies and students' needs. Middle school student schedules have been changed 5 times this year. Parents and teachers who have stood up against this unfairness have been harassed to leave the school or have been fired. One passenger that has been lost was our first grade teacher, Wendy Wells. Ms. Wells was a Tubman teacher for 4 years, but since she was an outspoken union rep for Tubman, she was harassed and then illegally fired in November of this year. Teachers fear that if they voice their opinion, they too will be fired from this great school. Tubman teachers and parents have tried to solve this problem, but our voices have not been heard. I and the people standing behind me are now taking this issue to a board that can lead our school back on track. We ask you to support parents and teachers at our school as we struggle to reclaim our voice and save our school. Be our North Star and lead us to what a charter school should be, where parents and teachers work together to better the lives of our children, our community, and our future. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Shivani Burrows Goodwill, third grade teacher, 2009 Teacher of the Year runner-up. Thank you for this opportunity. The mission of Harriet Tubman Village School is a global village that empowers heads, hearts, and hands to foster freedom through education. Harriet Tubman believed in the dignity of the human being and refused to let the inhumanity of slavery stop her. The outstanding and dedicated team of teachers at Tubman Village School believe in the empowering force of education to lead children of limited financial means to a brighter future, full of opportunities, a future that their parents never had. The teachers, the families, and the students at Harriet Tubman live this mission every day in their homes and classrooms. The evidence is clear. Test scores have progressively climbed with an increase of 33 points in 2010. Our students are not part of the achievement gap, but teachers have been achieving these results in a hostile environment where their voice has been shut out of decision-making by the school's board of trustees. Self-selected, they ignore or shout down any attempts by teachers to provide input, to ask for transparency, and to demand representation. There can be no honest dealings in a board that breaks its own rules in selecting biased membership and in refusing to follow the charter with regard to teacher dismissals. We ask you to exercise your authority to put a stop to the centralizing of power in an arbitrary self-selected body and to intervene with the Harriet Tubman Board to, first of all, launch an independent investigation of issues that represent violations of the charter. 2, to provide direct oversight of our governing board so that the bylaws can be changed to reinstate an open, transparent process of electing members who truly represent the voice of all stakeholders, and to nullify all illegal actions such as the illegal firing of a teacher, the selection of board members without application to the criteria, and to redress the public humiliation of parents and teachers at board meetings by board members and family members, and to ensure that in the immediate future that there are no further violations and especially no retaliation against any member of our community who has stepped forward to bring these issues to your attention. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nicole Bell, and I currently have 4 children who attend Harriet Tubman Village Charter School. Since my children have been at Tubman, I have witnessed many things I feel are hindering the success of my children at Tubman. For example, my first grade daughter's class was separated and rearranged several times. Children were taken out of her class and transferred to other classes. And then out of the blue, her teacher, who I thought was doing a wonderful job, the teacher who my daughter loved, was suddenly fired without proper parent notification. This termination was not done per the charter protocol. Now my child, who previously loved school, is no longer motivated to attend. Other examples include my son, who is in third grade and has had 3 different teachers this year before winter break, and is now wondering when the next change will come. My sixth grade daughter has had her schedule changed 5 times this year and has reported to me that Lydia Sinsky, the principal at Tubman, has come into their class and degraded them by telling them that if they don't behave in the sixth grade, they will be nothing in life. When I asked my daughter how this made her feel, she simply stated, like we're stupid. I don't feel that this is an appropriate way for a principal to talk to students, even in a rowdy class. And no child should be made to feel stupid. I feel that stability is an important factor in keeping kids motivated in school, and that is something that's missing at Tubman. All of these changes have caused my children to feel insecure and uncertain, and I'm unable to comfort them or reassure them, as I'm uncertain about what is going on from day to day at Tubman. The parents are not consulted or even notified about important changes. So in order to put my mind at ease, I attended a Tubman board meeting. A full 7 days prior to the meeting, I called one of the board members and requested that the board add to the agenda the issue of the legal termination of Wendy Wells. My request was ignored, and when I spoke up at the meeting, I was yelled at by one of the board members simply because I had a difference of opinion and spoke up for my children. So since the board was unwilling to address my concerns, I decided to attend coffee talks with the principal. The entire Tubman board also attended. My questions were still left unanswered, and the principal simply brushed off my concerns. And now a new person has joined the Tubman board, a man by the name of Kevin LaChapelle, who apparently played a key role in the horrific events that have transpired at Promise Charter School. The parents of Tubman don't want to see our school head down the same road Promise has. Tubman has a lot of potential to be an excellent school. The teachers are wonderful and have a strong desire to teach, but Tubman can only be excellent if swift action is taken to improve our school. Thank you so much for your
Thank
time.
Thank you. Thank you.
And again, Superintendent, I think, you know, like Promise, it sounds like these issues merit investigation and merit the protection of the parents and students and staff that would be willing to talk to us. And I don't want to editorialize a lot, other than to say, at our meeting last week, I talked about how we need to understand that that charter schools are public schools, but public schools are accountable to the public. And that starts with being accountable to the school community that includes the students, the parents, the teachers who are there every day. And charter schools cannot be mini dictatorships that exist on the dime of the public taxpayer. And we need to make sure that we guard against that. Okay, I think we're going to need to cut off non-agenda testimony at this point and go to our meeting, and then I will call everybody who has signed up to speak at the end of our regular meeting. Okay, so give people a minute to... They're one of the partners in the task force. Yeah.
So you know, we're behind the wall.
Yeah, we're over here.
I was
rise for the Pledge of Allegiance as before. Yeah, why don't we rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, please? Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, can we get a motion to adopt the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Vote. Okay, we're going to move straight to our preliminary proposals for the allocation of the charter school facilities under Prop 39. Superintendent, if you want to, you're going to move.
Thank you, President Barrera. I'd like to ask Roy McPhail, our demographer, to come forward, please. We've had two readings. We've had some guidance from the board, and I think Roy is here to summarize and put forward our recommendations given all of the previous engagement.
Okay.
Mr. Barrera, members of the board, at last Tuesday's meeting, the board approved preliminary offers for 7 elementary and K-8 charter schools and asked us to return today with different proposals for the remaining 3 high school charter schools. The board wished to locate high school level charter schools on high school campuses. There are very few district-operated high schools with space in our district, and additionally, potential changes to transportation policy may result in some of those few high schools with space growing in enrollment next year, which makes our job doubly challenging. As a result, and at the suggestion of the board, staff is proposing that the 3 high school charters be located on high school sites where there's currently space and where it's likely that transportation changes will mean there will still be space should policies change. And the report proposes the following co-locations: Arroyo Paseo at Madison High School, Ifton High School at Mission Bay, and Health Sciences at Morse. The board also asked staff last week to review the charge for additional space outside of Proposition 39, which has remained at $275 a square foot for the last 4 years. Note that the additional space charge only applies when a charter accepts a Prop 39 offer and wishes to access space above its Prop 39 allocation, if there's any available. As shown in the report, only one charter school, which is King Chavez Academy of Excellence, currently accesses additional space. And due to the uncertainties over the possible changes to district operations, especially in the area of transportation, and the effect these changes might have on enrollments at our district-operated schools, we're proposing that we do not offer any additional space to the new charters this year because we just don't know how the enrollments will pan out with the transportation changes. So that would mean only King Chavez would be affected by this the additional square foot charge. The Deputy Superintendent for Business and the Executive Director for Auxiliary Services worked with us to calculate the total annual cost of the district's maintenance plan, which equaled approximately $6.50 a square foot. As a result, the report recommends that the board increase the additional space charge from $2.75 to $4 this coming year, and then ultimately to $6.50 in 2011-2012 to equal our district maintenance plan charge. Please note again that this only applies to situations where charters are occupying space under Prop 39. It does not apply to potential charges for use of Revere or EB scripts, which would be completely outside of Prop 39. Today is our deadline for the district to make preliminary offers of space to charter schools, so we need your approval today to approve this report so that we can stay in compliance with Prop 39.
Okay.
Approval of items 1, 2, and 3. Recommendations 1, 2, and 3.
That was the full staff recommendation.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Ms. Jackson is moving approval of.
Second.
And we've got a second. We've got several public speakers, so I'll call them up now. Odessa Bradford, Wilson Nicario, Christine Nguyen, Robert Charlton, and Mohammed Sansom. And we're going to limit testimony to 2 minutes per speaker.
Hi,
Hi, yes, my name is Odessa Bradford. I took my son, Shaquille, out of Lincoln because of Lincoln School because of the way the staff was talking. The older gentleman's there. They was not a good role model for my child. His grades had dropped tremendously. He was failing. I took him out of there and put him in charter. And when he went to charter, his grades went up tremendously. And, I mean, his grades really scored high. And he's doing a lot better with Mr. Nicario and his wife and the staff there. They're very loving people, and they're really teaching these kids. You know, they're teaching them a good education. They're getting them geared towards college. And I really appreciate that. I thank God for that because my child grades really would have. And I appreciate it if you would keep our school in City Heights, please. Thank you.
My name is Wilson Nicario, 6955 Golf Crest Drive, San Diego, California, and I'm the principal at Ifton Charter High School. Respected board members, Superintendent Koba, and legal counsel, I come before you today to discuss the partnership between San Diego Unified School District and charter schools in general, and Ifton Charter High School in particular. I realize our charter barely passed in 2008 by a 3-2 vote due to the diversity issue at our parent school. My recruiting staff, teaching staff, my wife and I worked 0 days off from April 1 to the opening day of school to have a student group comprised of 70% Somali, which is still our biggest group, 30% African American, Latino, and Caucasian. We have gone out of our way to please the board to meet the diversity issue. We are currently in the process of recruitment to get an even greater diversity base. Our school foundation is based on the premise of getting the diverse student population of City Heights and Normal Heights to a four-year university. At this time, I want to read a schedule of one of the students that we have at our school. He transferred from one of the local high schools. His first classes was guitar first period, English second, art third, physical ed fourth, advisory, then earth science. Okay. Now, that same student registered at Ifton, and we immediately put him in the A to G requirements, which would be as for a freshman, English 1, chemistry, world history, algebra, and physical education, which meet the A to G requirements necessary for the entrance of a university, California school, or better. One might say, isn't this what school, what kids are supposed to take? I hold before you this study done by West Ed. It was presented to the Board of Education. Okay, so all of you might have a copy. We have two new members. Some of you read the report, like I said. While the school board adopted the A to G requirements a number of years ago as a graduation requirement for the district, it specifically states that ninth graders that are African-American, Latino, and English learners and socioeconomically disadvantaged may never get the opportunity to take such courses.
We're going to have to wrap up, Mr.
Okay. As pointed out, okay, art students do not have those types of issues. All we offer is A to G requirements. By putting us at Mission Bay High School, we are not serving the students in our charter.
Okay. 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 Thank you very much.
All right.
Thanks,
Mr. Chairman.
My name is Robert Charlton. I live in the city of San Diego. Good evening, board members and superintendent. I currently teach ninth grade chemistry at Ifton High School. I have worked for the last 5 years as an inner city school teacher for low socioeconomic students and second language learners. Ifton Charter High School needs to remain in City Heights because our students are experiencing success in rigorous academic classes for possibly the first time in their life. Last semester, I had 71 out of 73 students pass chemistry as a ninth grader. A class that is uniquely offered at our school, with one-third of those students receiving an A or a B. This is accomplished because we can offer them small class sizes of no more than 20 students. We can personalize the education towards their strengths. We can monitor their progress individually and keep them on the path to college. We can give them the caring and the time that usually only parents can offer. Our students know this. They respond to us with hard work. They want to come to our school. They want to learn and be successful, and I know they will if they stay with us. If we move to Mission Bay High School, our proposed site, a majority of our students will not be able to attend due to transportation or economic problems. We serve the Somali, Latino, and African-American populations of our current neighborhood. We belong in our neighborhood where our kids live. Please keep Ifton Charter High School an accessible option for our students. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Samsa Mohammed. I am single mom with the 5 kids. And if you guys move Ifton High School, it's going to be a problem for me to take them to school. So please keep them the place they are right now. Thank you so much.
Good evening. My name is Christine Nguyen. I am the social science teacher at Ifton High School. Our mission statement is that every child shall be successful regardless of circumstance. And I should know this best myself because I come from a family of refugees during the Vietnam War. So we came here with nothing. And the one thing that I value the most is having the chance to be with teachers who really cared and gave me the opportunity to reach college and go to UCLA. And I feel that the students that we're serving right now, I've seen a complete turnaround in them. I've seen them come from a very troubled background, whether that be as children of refugees coming from famine and war, to come here and be English language learners and want to push through and make sure that they get the education that they deserve. I've also seen children who originally were facing challenges, at-risk students that have been able to really get into education and have that desire to go to college and further their life. And I really feel that if we move ourselves out of the whole area of City Heights and we move to a distance where parents are unable to transport their children to, that will be very detrimental to these students who really need our help, these English language learners, these students who are sons and daughters of refugees like myself. And so I work every day to serve them, and I really would appreciate it if you would please keep Ifton High School at City Heights. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay, we've got Brian Thurman and Lisa Berlanga.
Good evening, Mr. President, members of the board, Mr. Kalba, and staff. Appreciate you having us up here tonight. I am the principal at Arroyo Paseo. My name is Brian Thurman. I live in Del Cerro. And I'm not going to tell you all the details of our school. We have an Eagle Scout, or we have students interviewing at Harvard this week. We've got students working at Scripps Research Institute. We're qualified as a Navy Tier 1 school. But our facilities are a need right now. We have, just as an example real quick, our principal's office, teacher lounge, counselor's office, teacher work room, board meeting room, lunch room, mail room, supply room, speech pathologist room are all in one space, smaller than your stage here, 180 square feet. So needless to say, our facilities are in need for our school. The relocation, the offer that is being proposed to move to the Claremont Area Madison High School simply won't work for our students, for our families, for all the reasons you've heard before. Our charter is written to serve the students in City Heights. We believe it's a worthy cause, something that helps the district to serve the district students within City Heights. Our students, as you've seen from our proposal, are from Hoover, from Crawford primarily, but other cities, other high schools throughout the Unified School District. Our total cost for that building is $251,000 a year. So even with these facilities, we have all the usual, we have very high achieving students, academically talented. We also have numerous students who have been in and out of juvenile hall, students that are on probation, emancipated students from their families at 16, 17, students who are parents themselves, and students recovering from drug addiction, things that we're serving right in the City Heights neighborhood that would be really difficult and challenging for us to do, having to move somewhere else. Our academic results, however, we grew 36 points this last year in API, met all of our API subgroups. We had more growth than 39 of the 53 reporting high schools within the Unified School District, and more growth than 105 of the 130 reporting high schools in the county. So thank you very much. Appreciate your time tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, President Barrera, Superintendent Koba, board members. I'm Lisa Berlanga with the California Charter Schools Association. I just want to do a quick reminder that Prop 39 was approved several years ago by the voters. Part of the deal with that was that the bond passage rate would come from 2/3 to 55%. The intent behind Prop 39 was that charter schools would be supported in finding facilities, because facilities is one of the biggest hurdles for charter schools in the state. I spoke on the first preliminary offers for Prop 39, was thrilled. It was the process that we've been going through with the past few years, mostly with Roy and his office working on it. It felt very supportive. It felt very fair. Felt like the board was really trying to get charter school staff. This offer that's on the table, not so much. You're offering two high school programs. One is actually 15 miles away from where they are. Takes two freeways to get there. If Ifton and Arroyo Paseo are asked to move to Claremont and Mission Bay, they're all new schools. They're starting over. That was not what they were developed. What they were, the students that they were created to serve is in City Heights, and to move them from that is going to destroy their programs. There is also a school that has been discussed here at the meetings, Crawford, which is 2 miles from both schools. The administrative sites have been removed from the offers. We talked about administrative sites being possibly a better solution than sharing sites. Administrative sites are potential negotiations with the charter schools. Charter schools in the future could bring money to those sites to upgrade them. Those have now been taken off the table. We've been talking about those sites for years. We were hoping that this study would make progress on that. Now those are gone. Additional square footage charge. Prop 39 only serves in-district students. If you don't allow charters to purchase additional space, then those class sizes that are small and so important to some of you will no longer be able to do it. Class sizes will be higher than the district because you allocate space based on your class sizes, and then you're not giving us space for our out-of-district students, so our class sizes are going to go up. This does not feel like the supportive offer that San Diego Unified has been offering for the past few years and working with their charter schools, and the charter school community is very disappointed.
Okay, we've got a motion and a second to approve the staff recommendation. Any questions or comments from board members? Dr. Evans?
Yes, first of all, with Mr. McPhail, and I apologize because I know you were explaining, but we have the three schools that are listed here, and I didn't understand exactly the explanation for the other schools that were on the previous list and what has happened with that.
The three schools?
Besides these three. The
you approved last week. Preliminary offers for all the other.
Okay, that's right. So they were all approved except for these three.
Yes.
So these were the three remaining that we were left to look at today. Okay, that's where I got confused. Okay.
And this is his first offer. This is not the final. So
these are preliminary offers.
Thank you. Right.
Mr. Barnett, did you?
Just to make sure I understand. And I supported the action last time to, when these were initially being looked at, putting at non-high school locations and asking staff to look at high school locations. Two questions. One of the speakers said that the non-school site, quote, administrative sites were taken off the list, but those were regarding the other sites, or were they even considered for these three?
At last week's board meeting, the board voted to approve offering those sites. That is what the board approved. The item I think that was struck through on the agenda this week is not to do with taking that offer back of offering those sites. We were going to talk about perhaps the charging or the fees, but they're still in play.
Okay, so that was a statement that was is not correct.
Yeah.
Those are still in play. I understand your comment about actions that the board may take in the coming weeks or months on transportation and other issues could affect the space availability of other high school sites.
Correct.
And therefore, that is how you narrow down to these three sites, because they would not be affected, at least as getting more crowded. They might get potentially less crowded.
At last week's board meeting, we were asked to look at high school sites. There were only a handful of high school sites with space. A couple of the ones that are in the vicinity could be affected, and we do have to take this into consideration. There is a potential for transportation changes, and if students do return to some of those facilities, the space that we see now might be gone, and I think we did have to take that into consideration, as well as where we have space.
So
we have very little space.
The board, depending on what the board does or does not do, as Ms. Jackson mentioned, these are preliminary offers, and then if the board, whatever decision they make in the next couple of months, still allows space at other high schools that are not on this list, that's something that could still be open to negotiation or discussion, or where does that fit?
Well, we have a timeline we must follow, right, and it will depend on when your decisions come in. That by
what's
March,
the deadline?
March the 1st, okay. The charters must get back to us with any concerns they have about the offer, and by April the 1st, we must make our final offer. So I guess we have March and April to really wrap this up.
Okay, and one last question, and this, you may not know the answer to this, although you seem to have the answer to most questions, so I'll see if I can stump McPhail here. It's been mentioned concerns about transportation by some of the speakers tonight. I do know that certain charter schools get Title I allocations. There is provisions within at least the Title I funds that the district gets to be used for transportation for qualifying students. Can the charters use the Title I funds they get for transportation purposes?
That is certainly one area I do know nothing about.
Okay.
So I don't know.
So, thank you.
Just really quick. There are other charter schools that basically what they do in essence is they purchase an MTS transportation card and offer it to their students. I don't know if it's necessarily Title I, but I do know they do it out of their own funds. So.
Okay. Mr. Beiser? Yeah.
The purchasing of additional space, you said at this point in time that's off the table?
What we would recommend this year, because of some of the policy decisions you're going to make, mm-hmm. that we do not offer additional space beyond their Prop 39 allocation this year, because there are so many variables, we just don't know how much extra space we'll have to offer.
Right.
And I would prefer not to offer additional space
until after we know for sure it's
right.
going to be there.
Yes.
Okay. The other question that I have is when you looked at the per square foot charge for the purchase of additional space out, and you'd figured out the maintenance rate is $6.50 a square foot.
Yes.
Could you explain a little bit more how you came to $6.50 a square foot, or what is that reflective of, and what would that cost be? What would that $6.50
right.
a square foot be used for?
I think I'll defer to the deputy superintendent who knows about the district maintenance plan.
Our maintenance plan on an annual basis is $92 million. We have between 14 and 15 million square feet that we maintain. So that rate is for the ongoing maintenance of the facility. It does not include the cleaning of the facility nor the landscaping of the facilities, but it is the ongoing regular and routine maintenance.
Okay, so we as a school district then, we need $6.50 per square foot to maintain our buildings.
For the basic maintenance.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, I'm going to vote to approve the staff recommendation tonight because we need to move the item forward. I do share the concerns of the parents here from the two City Heights schools. I know this is a very difficult situation because I also share the concerns of the folks from the middle schools, who have valid concerns about high school students on their campuses. So this begins the process of negotiation. I hope that we can identify some creative solutions through this process of negotiation, but we definitely need to get that process moving tonight. So with that, please vote. Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, we'll now move on to item C2. This is the update of our charter school selection site for the downtown library.
And Moises has that criteria update for you.
Right. Go ahead, Moises. All right.
Well, good evening, members of the board and superintendent. This item is an update. It's an informational item, so there's no action required on this particular item at this time. Per prior board direction, to develop an open and public application process for the selection of a charter school to occupy the downtown library site, we have developed a tentative timeline for the board's review, and it's attached in your board docs. As the timeline shows, the district would post an intent to apply form on our website to gauge the level of interest of for the downtown library facility from charter school operators. This facility is not expected to be ready until the fall of 2013. Working backwards from the fall 2013 date, we have developed a month-by-month process, which is in your timeline, where the board will be presented with criteria to be applied to the interested charter schools. The first reading would be in March of 2011, and followed by an April adoption. followed by the board selection of the charter school to occupy the downtown library site on June 2011 approximately. Again, this is only specific to the question of the assignment public process to assign the space at a charter school, and it really doesn't encompass the whole downtown library project, rather just the assignment of charter school at this site. Okay. And we've also developed the tentative intent to apply form. Again, it's also in your board docs, and if you have any questions or any guidance really at this point. Again, no action needed at this point.
Mr. Beiser?
How many classrooms are going to be at this school, Brary?
At this point, it's not really clear to me. Again, I'm not really here to talk about the facility itself. We're just talking about the process for the charter school. I don't know if the Deputy Superintendent of Business might have an idea. There's a lot of things that are still in the works. We're 3 years out, so a lot of it still needs to be determined.
But to the extent that we have high school charters that are looking for a home,
mm-hmm.
you know, I just think that may be something to think about.
We've been informed by the architect that the capacity should be in the ballpark of 400 to 450. Students overall on that site, depending on how class size is for that particular charter school, but you're looking at a 450 student capacity.
As a district, we have about 180 square feet per student. It would work out 400. It's about 72,000 square feet.
Right. Yeah, Dr. Evans.
Just one question on the application process. I'm assuming that's being set up to be open to existing charters as well as new charters.
Correct.
Okay, great.
And at this point, it's really an effort on the district's behalf to gauge whether there's 10 charter schools that are interested. Is it 20, 30? We really don't have that gauge at this point, so this really is the first step to have that a ballpark figure.
Okay, thank you, Marissa. Okay, we'll move on to item C3. So this is the public hearing to consider the new charter petition for the Nexus Charter Middle School. We've got a few speakers on this item. I'll call up David Yeager, Cinda Dowdy, and Deidre Alpert.
Good evening, board members. My name is Cinda Dowdy, and I'm will be the new director of the new charter school. I am currently director at Darnell Charter School, and excited about the opportunity of opening this new school to serve middle school students. I wanted just to share a little bit with you about what makes this new charter school different and why we're so excited about it. And you have that information in your board packet as well. But just a quick synopsis is that it's going to be a hybrid charter school. So it will be a combination of online face-to-face learning online learning combined with face-to-face learning. And when I say online, I mean that it actually would be occurring at the school site, not necessarily something where students are doing independent study. We have been working very hard with a couple of other agencies to develop and research curriculum that we think will really support our students in customizing education. So our goal is to provide an education that meets each student's needs. One of the things we know that works well in education is differentiating instruction by each student's need, and we also know that's a huge challenge because we've got a classroom with a teacher, one teacher, and 20 to 30 and possibly more students, and they're trying to address all of those different needs. So what we're hoping to do with this program is to be able to actually customize an education based on each individual student's needs with the support of technology, and so that the technology would be adaptive to student learning and actually progress with them as they learn, and at the same time that face-to-face learning will be available in the form of small group tutoring and working with individual students who aren't succeeding with the technology curriculum. The other thing that we're looking to do with this model is to actually extend learning time within the same boundaries of funding that we currently receive in the state. So we're looking at being a little bit creative in the way that we stagger our school day and that we also extend our school year by using technology as a support to do so. So I know that this is just a public hearing, but I just wanted to make myself available to answer any questions because I know that this is a very unique model and there's probably some very unusual ideas that we're putting forth for this charter school. So,
great. Thank you, Sandy.
Thank you.
President Barrera, Superintendent Calba, and members of the board. I'm Dee Dee Alpert. I'm a member of the board of the Girard Foundation, and we are here in support of the Nexus Charter School. The mission statement of the Girard Foundation is to improve K-12 education in San Diego County by supporting projects and programs for systemic change. We've been supportive of many programs within the San Diego Unified District, including Girard Prep that worked at Lincoln High School in providing extra counseling and support for low-income students trying to apply to college and to help them assist them with their SAT exams, the principal's executive program, which gave principals the opportunity to learn management program and be involved with modern management practices from local businesses and civic leaders, and many people from San Diego Unified participated in that. Project Lead the Way, which is a national program that provides for middle and high school STEM courses, and we provided the support at Mission Bay High School for that program. As our board at Girard assessed how we could help create systemic change in K-12 education, we looked at the idea of blended education, how technology could be integrated to provide a student-centered education system that allowed teachers the time and support to teach at a higher level than ever before. For the past 6 months, with the assistance of national groups, we have been working with these ideas, and we supported two teams in developing, one from North San Diego County, one from San Diego Unified, as they worked to design a new education model that would produce better results with more effective use of resources. Just last week, our board met to look at the two proposals, and I'm pleased to tell you that the board unanimously agreed to support the Nexus proposal. We are excited by the proposal and believe it will provide a laboratory for innovative ideas that can potentially change the way we deliver education in more than just one school. For this reason, Girard Foundation, which has $19 million in assets in the foundation, has agreed to provide close to $1 million to help with the startup costs for Nexus Charter. We are also committed to ongoing support until the school is able to be fully self-sufficient. We hope this will allay any concerns you might have about how this school would be financed, because we will be there to back it up. Thank you very much.
Good evening, President Barrera, Superintendent Quoba, and board members. My name is David Yeager. I'm currently the chairperson of Darnell Charter School and was asked to be a part of the design team by Cinda Dowdy. Just wanted to provide some additional information to you guys on the budgeting and how we're working with Girard Foundation. You do have a budget in the charter application that was provided that did show deficit spending in both startup year two and year three. In working with Girard Foundation, we have fully expanded that budget to include all costs, and are happy to say that starting at the beginning of year four, the school will be self-sustaining on the ADA and other public funding that is received, and do not anticipate the need for any further philanthropic support from that point forward. In addition, we anticipate to have at the end of year five a balance of $320,000 in our reserve to help support cash flow issues and ongoing operations should issues occur from then. As we prove our model in the first 3 years, we hope to expand our relationship with Girard Foundation, continue to work with them in a lab environment, and share our knowledge with other schools throughout San Diego and beyond to help implement this model elsewhere. Thank you.
Okay, this is public hearing. Ms. Jackson?
Just one quick question. I know I'll have more after we finish, but is this going to be an extension of Darnell?
No.
No? Okay. All right.
This is actually a new charter school, so it's proposed to be a 6-7-8 middle school.
Right.
And as you notice in your board packet, we are looking for facilities right now. One of the proposed ideas was to locate it on the Darnell campus. Uh-huh. However, Darnell is a very collaborative charter school, and so the board will be taking into account whether or not the staff wants it there, whether or not the parents want it there, before we bring that idea forward fully developed. So that process is going on now. If it does not work out to locate it at the Darnell Charter School, then we'll be looking for facilities in the same area. Because as the other charter schools that you have spoken with, you've heard tonight, our desire is really to impact the student achievement of our underserved population that reside in that mid-city corridor. So we'll be looking for facilities in the same area. We're not asking for Prop 39
now,
right now.
But I think that staff needs to hear that, because I think you're the third or fourth charter school, and all of them saying they want to be in that area. And we don't, you know, unless, you know, we can build some more school facilities, then we won't have any school facilities to give anyone in that area.
Right. Okay. So we've just really, having worked in that area for the last 8 years, I'm very aware of the needs of that population of students and have a commitment to serving those students. Thank you. Any other questions?
Board members, any other questions or comments on? Yeah, Mr. Burnett.
One, I notice one of the options you're looking at is to lease land from San Diego Unified and develop it. I'm assuming that is outside of the whole pro forma that Mr. Yeager is talking about, as far as...
Absolutely. So this would be, we believe that there may be some ground space. Mm-hmm. A ground lease would fall outside of Prop 39, and I know that the real estate department, I spoke with them briefly, says it's a whole series of processes and procedures that we would need to go through in order to find out if that space was available, and if so, you know, what it might look like to lease it. But if that... We're just trying to think creatively. And if that were to happen, then certainly it would fall. In my understanding, it's ground. It's not a building. So I believe it would fall outside of Prop 39.
And to follow up on that, we do have in the budget almost $1 million from startup to year four for facilities improvement and development. So there is some money built into it for whatever facility we are in for improvements in there.
Okay.
Further questions?
All right. With no further questions, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Great. We'll move on to our action item, our charter petition for the City Heights Prep Academy. And we've got one speaker signed up, Marnie Nair.
Good evening, board. My name is Marnie Nair, and I live at 4251 Estrella Avenue in San Diego. We are all honored to be here tonight as you vote on the City Heights Prep petition, and we want to thank you for the time you have taken to review our petition. We especially want to thank Moises Aguirre, Susan Park, and the various other people at San Diego Unified who have taken the time to thoughtfully review our petition and give us suggestions to make City Heights Prep a better school. This is an exciting night for us. It's the culmination of a year and a half of hard work and lots of investment by so many people. It is perhaps most exciting for those of us who are City Heights residents and parents as we look forward to a new opportunity for our kids. In anticipation of your decision tonight, we've been mobilizing to make sure that every family living in East City Heights who desires a local, community-based, rigorous college preparatory education for their child has the opportunity to apply to attend City Heights Prep this next September. An amazing group of resident community leaders are so excited about this new opportunity that they have taken on full responsibility for organizing, planning, and hosting outreach events in their respective communities. These are set to occur in every language you can imagine, including Amharic, Bantu, Cambodian, Karen, Spanish, Somali, Sudanese, Swahili, and even in English. To date, we have 13 events on the calendar, with more being added daily. In addition to events at places like ProKids, we have parents organizing events at their elementary school parent meetings, in their apartment complexes, and in local community centers. We have even been invited to introduce families to City Heights Prep at a Sudanese referendum party. What an honor to be included in a day that celebrates long-awaited freedom for the Sudanese people. We are all here tonight to show you how important City Heights Prep is to us and to urge you to vote in our favor this evening. I am also here to answer any questions you may have about our petition and our plans. And in hopeful expectation, we have plans to celebrate afterwards at Fatima's Restaurant in East City Heights. Please know that you're welcome to join us. We are also here to invite you to visit City Heights Prep next year. We promise that when you come, you will see a school that is reflective of all the beauty and diversity of City Heights and a place of excitement and hope, where bright young minds are being prepared to excel in college and to lead San Diego into the future. Thank you.
Can I just ask a couple of questions?
The conditions that the staff are recommending, or the changes, are there any that you do not agree with or support?
I think that we addressed all the changes. Yeah, we addressed all the changes.
Okay. I think you said you had had a site or building identified, and do you have a lease based on approval of the board already negotiated or for your site?
We have an agreement with a property that's on the north side of Kalina Park. Yeah.
Right.
We're working on the conditional use permits and all that stuff, but yeah.
Okay. What's the length of the term of the lease that you're looking at? You've not signed it yet?
We haven't finalized it, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Board members, any other questions or comments? I think, Dr. Neer, the only comment I would have, and we've discussed this a little bit, is particularly with what we heard at the beginning of this meeting with a couple of schools, I know that there's an active strategy to have the voice of parents in the community involved in the school. I'd encourage you over time to look at making sure that that voice actually has a place on the board, on the governing board, so that we don't end up with a disconnect between the governing board and the community thinking out
Agreed.
A few years.
Yeah.
But
definitely.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, do we have a motion to approve?
I move to approve.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
All right. Mr. Barnett?
Well, they voted. I wanted to suggest some conditions, or additional conditions, provisions, I guess is the correct term. Number one, that the Board of Education exercise its right to appoint a board member to the, and so this would be a amendment or a second motion, depending on if the maker and the seconder agree with them. That would be number one. Number two, because of the economic environment we're in and the school funding situation, which obviously affects charter schools as well as us, I would recommend that we limit the term of the agreement to 2 years. So those would be the two items that I would recommend adding to the motion. If they're acceptable, if not, I'll make a second motion afterwards.
So do you want this as an amendment to your motion, Mr. Beiser, or do you want this?
I'll withdraw my motion.
Withdraw your motion.
You have to withdraw your second.
Well, no, I support the amendment, so I if you want to make
so
that motion.
Second the amendment.
Well, if you're withdrawing your motion, then I'll make a new motion if you withdrew your second.
Yes.
I'll make a motion to approve with the additional terms, I guess, if that's the correct term we're using, for that we, San Diego Unified, have a position on the board that will later be appointed, and that we also limit the term of the charter to 2 years.
I second that.
Okay, so we've got a motion and a second. Any further?
And let me just give a little more explanation to that. you know, obviously there are significant costs in creating a charter, and there are, and that's one reason I was asking about the lease, is because if you're going to have furniture, tenant improvements and so forth, amortizing those over time is certainly an issue. But I think given the a lot of the issues we've heard earlier tonight, as well as startup issues, then this gives a little more oversight, if you will. And then assuming, and given the great resumes of the members and the incredible community support we've seen here, I would fully expect that when they came back in 2 years that it would be a successful venture, but this maybe keeps a little edge on the organization to so that was my thinking of adding those.
Can I ask a clarifying question? Does that mean we would reapply for reapproval in the third year, before the third year?
And the comment I want to make, and I think it's just to be fair, is not so much related to the specifics of the City Heights PREP's application as much as, at least in my opinion, the board's decision to exercise more oversight over charters so that we don't run into some of the problems. As Mr. Brera said, he wanted to make sure, he encouraged you to have ongoing apparent participation on the board and so forth. If we just have charters and in a blanket way approve them for 5 years, there's not as much opportunity to intervene if those type of things don't happen. I understand that that's what you're going to do and that's what you plan to do, so I don't see an issue. So I don't want it to be taken in any way as a negative for this application. It's just more of an intention of the board to really have careful oversight to support charter schools and also to make sure that they're fulfilling the mission.
Thank you for clarifying.
Okay, we've got a motion and a second. With no further questions or comments, please vote. Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and next is our petition for the America's Finest Charter School. We'll give City Heights PREP just a minute to...
We weren't planning to speak, but if you'd like us to, we will. We weren't planning to.
If you want to speak, please fill out a speaker's item.
We'll just answer questions. We didn't have anything planned.
Okay. Okay.
I would move approval.
Okay, we've got it. We've got a...
With the recommendations as you just made. Okay. I would move approval with the staff recommendation with conditions and recommendation that was previously made with 2 years and
a board position.
Okay.
This is with the America Finest Charter.
Okay. Do we have a second to Ms. Jackson's motion?
Second.
Okay. Any further comments or questions? We've got, looks like, a full public comments. Okay, Lisa Berlanga and Sandra Martinez.
Thank you, President Brera, Superintendent Coba, board members. Lisa Berlanga, California Charter School Association. Certainly within the board's purview to approve a new charter for anywhere from 1 to 5 years. I just want to throw in, at a two-year mark for a renewal, there's no data really to look at. So if you approve a charter for 1 year, there's no data. If you approve a charter for 2 years, there's 1 year of data to look at, which is their baseline year. So there's not much to look at in terms of a renewal at a two-year mark. You're not going to have anything to look at that point. So I understand more oversight, it's creating more work, but you're not going to see any sort of track record from a charter school that's only been operating for a year. And additionally, charter schools have to start the renewal process a year, basically, before, according to the accountability process that the charter office put together, the request is that a renewal comes in October 15th of the year before you're going to expire. So the charter school that was just approved will be submitting their renewal document next October. So, you know, timing is it's something to consider. 2 years is rather brief, not a lot to look at. If you want to shorten terms, 3 or 4 might be more timely.
Thanks, Lisa. Sandra Martinez.
Good afternoon. We're not going to speak to you today about our charter. We were here a couple of weeks ago, actually December 7th, but we are available to you if you have any questions. I am the lead petitioner, Sandra Martinez, and Jen Perry is another lead petitioner.
Yeah, I'll just suggest an amendment to Ms. Jackson's motion that that we look at this as a three-year proposal. And the reason for that as well is when the renewal comes up, it's a renewal for 5 years. So at that point, you know, I think we do need to see a little bit more.
I'll just make my motion over again.
Okay, please do.
Withdraw it. Yeah. My motion is that we approve this charter with the staff conditions for a period of 3 years, and that we also appoint a member to the board.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Barnett?
Yeah, the reason I picked 2 years is, you know, I realize there may not be student performance data, but, you know, there are, in this tough times, just getting the students signed up, committed to come to the schools, the first 2 years is critical. I mean, as far as getting those numbers and meeting those, and if they don't, we need to know sooner than later, because that's where fairly early the financial viability would be known to us as being viable or not. And they have very aggressive, especially the previous one had a much more aggressive student ratio. So I think that's really my issue, is we'll know pretty quickly if they meet those goals or not, and whether it's financially viable and their support of the community and parents to attend it. So that's why I felt the 2 years was a reasonable number.
Hi, Dr. Yes. In terms of I see the points both about the 2 years and the 3 years. I think 2 years is plenty of time to see if it's really getting off to the right start and catching if things are not being done correctly and so forth. But then my concern is what Mr. Brewer brought up about at that point, if the 2 years doing the five-year renewal, because my personal preference, and I didn't make the law, so it wouldn't be this way, would be we would review after 2 years and then do the full review 3 years later at the end of the 5 years. But if in fact legally, at that first review, we're required to, and we don't even have the option. I know when we're renewing, we don't have the option of choosing how much time. I guess that's what we heard earlier. So then, therefore, if that's 5 years, I would be a little reluctant at the end of 2 years to say I want this school to continue for five more years. Whereas at the end of 3 years, I think it would be a little bit more of a balance between not waiting too long but going up for the 5 years.
I think Scott makes a good point about wanting to really take a quick snapshot after 2 years and see how things are developing financially and accountability-wise. But speaking as an educator and a teacher, sometimes the programs that you create need a little tweaking, and that takes a couple of years to fine-tune and get parents to understand the programs that you have to support their own, to support their children, and to get the buy-in of the staff so that they're all going in the same direction. So to really measure the success of academic initiatives and extended day programs and some of the other things that they're doing, I think, you know, we need to give them a little bit more time, a little more breathing room, so that they can make those types of academic adjustments and support their kids. So for that reason, I would support the three-year period. Also, it's much better to have 2 years of API data.
Yeah.
In addition to that, the startup funds will carry them the first couple of years anyway. That they'll be receiving quite a bit of startup funds. Both charters will.
Okay, so we've got a motion and a second. Please vote. Okay, yeah, yes.
Assumed you would want. I guess in order to have consensus, I will move we reconsider the previous motion for City Heights Prep and change it to a three-year term.
And I just want to check with our legal counsel as a point of order. Is this?
As long as you all know what you're voting for and agree to re-vote on it, then you can make any motion.
Okay. Well, I don't know if we've ever met
that. Does
that
criteria always apply?
Yeah. Okay.
I'll second Scott's motion to augment the City Heights prep to a three-year.
Now, to reconsider a motion, do we have to reconsider the action, or do we just, is this motion, when changing it, acceptable, or do you have to take two motions to do it? I've never done this before.
Again, as long as you all know what you're voting for and are amenable to another vote, I'm not sure it's particularly important. Robert's rules are merely a guide here.
Okay. All right.
I support the motion.
All right. I think we're clear that we're adding a third year to the City Heights prep petition. Okay. All in favor? Okay, great. And now we've got additional non-agenda item public testimony. And again, we'll limit this to 2 minutes per speaker. Debbie Smith, Rosemary Aranda, and Vanessa Forsyth. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Yeah, we do. Please go ahead.
Good evening, board members. My name is Debbie Smith. I am the English learner support teacher at Freeze Elementary. Freeze is located south of 94 next to Spring Valley. We have 450 students, 100% of which participate in the free and reduced lunch program. We are ethnically diverse with 50% English learners, 57% Hispanic, 20% African American, 8% Filipino, 5% White and Hmong and Somali. The needs of a school cannot and should not be determined by enrollment alone. There are many factors that make up the needs of a school. As no children are alike, no schools are the same. Each is individual and unique. With the current funding ratio for next year's budget, Freeze is funded at the lowest amount of $396 per student, and yet our students have the highest needs emotionally, physically, and academically. With this allocation, we will not be able to afford a nurse, and we must reduce our counselor time to 2 days a week. We do not have the resources to plead to a PTA or a foundation to make up the financial deficit. I ask that you reconsider your funding ratio and consider Freeze's immense needs. Due to the increase in class size, we will lose 8 teachers, and our K-3 classrooms will nearly double as we now have ARRA funding. Many of our families struggle to make ends meet. Our students face many challenges: single-parent homes, foster families, incarcerated parents, grandparents raising grandchildren. These children need all the support services they can get for a quality education. In short, I ask that you consider raising class size at Freeze in smaller increments. In short, please consider Freeze Elementary as unique and special as it is. Number one, increase the distribution of dollars per student so that our students can receive the services they desperately need. Yeah. Number two, increase our K-3 class size in smaller increments each year instead of putting our students from a class of 16 this year into a class of 30 next year. Last things. We know that the best way for our low socioeconomic students to succeed in life and change their economic situation is through a quality education that lays a strong foundation in elementary school. Students need a program that supports them socially, emotionally, as well as academically. We need the resources to do this, and I implore you to reconsider your allocation to us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Rosie Aranda, and I am a proud second-grade teacher at Freeze Elementary School. I've been with the district about 16 years. What you give time and attention to is what you value. At Freeze Elementary School, our teachers believe that raising class size from 16 to 1 to 29 to 1 in K through 3 will have a jolting impact on our English language learners and all students. At Freeze Elementary School, our teachers have fully embraced reading and math interventions. These small group interventions give those students in need the chance to learn what they may have missed. All students deserve that chance. At Freeze Elementary School, we suggest that you raise our class size more gradually. We ask the board to redistribute the allocation of money. Why? because we are currently receiving the lowest amount of money per child than any other school of this size in the district. The Freeze Elementary allocated budget is so lean that it robs our students of the time and attention they deserve and need in the classroom. We appeal to the board to value our free students and community and do the right thing. Give us the budget to maximize each student's academic success. Thank you.
Vanessa Forsyth, Eileen Griffiths, Mary Pat Hutt, Pamela Stalock. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Hey, thanks. Good evening. My name is Pam Stalock, and I'm a teacher, a fourth grade teacher at Zamorano. Zamorano Fine Arts Academy opens its doors in 1986 to 1,100 students instead of the proposed enrollment of 586. It's the first of its kind, a visual arts school in Southern California. Zamorano is a residential magnet, and we have a 77% poverty level in our school community. These are the students whose parents are trying hard to put clothes on their children, put food on the table, have a place to stay at night. They worry about where the next paycheck is coming and what's next. These are the very students who make sure they come to school daily just so they don't miss out on our art program. This is what brings them to our school. Zamorano's art magnet is their life and breath. Zamorano began with 200 magnet students when we first opened, and our number has continued to rise to 608 students currently. From those 608 magnet students, many come from out of the area. Even though we are an extremely large elementary school, there has always been an injustice for funding for our visual arts program. We still have the same budget for 200 with little increase. The arts teach kids to be more tolerant and open. The arts allow kids to express themselves creatively. The arts promote individuality, bolster self-confidence, and improve overall academic performance. The more art classes taken, the higher the test scores, according to many studies done. Zamorano continues to make higher academic gains, and we are getting closer to that 900 target. Zamorano is a showcase school in which we have had many accolades in the past. Two Blue Ribbon Awards, honorable mention in Great Schools of America, a California Distinguished School, two Title I Improvement Awards, and even a visit from Bill and Hillary Clinton, who raved about our visual art program. Our program is everywhere in San Diego, from student pieces on exhibit in community businesses, art museums, corner coffee cafes, to murals on freeways, to displays at Limbord Airport, to permanent house artwork in the Superior Courthouse. I'm going to cut it. Just remember that for most important is our students' artwork hanging in every Zamorano schoolhouse, student house, on every refrigerator, a place of work on office walls and in grandparents' homes, in every classroom, on every window, on any given day. Zamorano Visual Arts speaks volume. We are only asking for the funding of $90,000 for one art teacher as compared to other schools who are requesting much, much more. Okay. We strongly believe that our students and staff
thank
members.
Thank you, Ms. Stalock. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Vanessa Forsyth, Eileen Griffiths, Mary Pat Hutt, Jane Fulkerson, Angela Knight, Aaron Beard.
Good evening, Board. Thank you for your patience in hearing us. My name is Jane Fulkerson. I'm the project resource teacher at Freeze Elementary. It's an arts and culture magnet school currently. I come here today to ask the Board to seriously consider the ramifications of eliminating all funding for our magnet program at Freeze. As mentioned before, we're 100% Title I. And through our magnet program, it's a standards-based magnet. Our students develop an appreciation for and an understanding of the power of the arts in their lives. For over 10 years now, our students have worked alongside actors, artists, dancers, and musicians as well as attended performances all over the city, funded largely through the generosity of our 25 partners. Our partnerships range from the Old Globe, La Jolla Playhouse, San Diego Ballet, the Opera, the Guild of Puppetry, and more. And many others of those partners have given our students windows into a world much larger than the one in which they live. Our magnet work has inspired dreams, produced published authors and artists, and enriched the lives of all of our students. Without the ability to fund the magnet teacher resource position, who is instrumental in bringing these partnerships together, holding them together, and arranging for all of these experiences, our magnet will die. We simply will not have a magnet. It's not the equivalent to transfer it to an art resource teacher position. The work that the resource teacher position is doing now coordinates everything that I just described to you. Without that, the doors to the theaters and symphony halls will be closed to the children of our school. Once again, those who are among the most needy in the district will have their dreams curtailed, their possibilities diminished, and their choices limited. The work we do at Freeze cannot be translated into an art prep teacher. We cannot fund this position ourselves, nor can our foundation provide this resource. Please consider allowing our children the same access to artistic and cultural experiences that other more affluent students have by funding our magnet teacher position. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Angela Knight, and I'm a parent from Freeze Elementary, a magnet school in District E. I know that we are all here to serve the children and that you must make hard decisions with what you've been given. But a school like Freed's needs extra consideration. Our school's 100% free breakfast and lunch. We are at a 400 API with Title I funding as it is. And where are we going to be next year with just one principal and 14 teachers? Our magnet program is probably the only way some of our children will interact with art, music, and dance. Magnet opens their minds to a bigger world out there. It takes it out of the TV or a book and puts it in their hands. We have been asked to keep our magnet with no funds to run a school on bare bones that is already inundated. It's like all the cows are dead and you still want steak for dinner. Please, I know budget comes from Sacramento, but if nothing else, please save our magnet. On behalf of Reese, thank you for hearing me. Thank you.
Aaron Beard, Teresa Tinkle, Inelra Aguilar, Jose Villascusa, Becky Breedlove, and Rob German. Go ahead, please.
Okay. Hello, my name is Teresa Tinkle, and I'm a proud parent of Promise Charter. I have here a letter that will be sent to you guys by this Friday. I'm going to read a portion of it. Our school is no stranger to parent and teacher uprisings. In 2002, a rumor was spread by Pam Clark, other teachers, and some parents that founding board members were embezzling money from the school. The small group of parents and teachers convinced the school committee and ousted the founding board members. After this, Pam Clark and the other teachers and the small group of parents took control of the governing board. In 2005, the same group of teachers and parents spread similar rumors about Principal Victor Nunez, and in a few months forced him to resign from his job. After they ousted Mr. Nunez, Pam Clark brought her friend Olivia Flores as the principal. However, that only lasted a few years. In 2008, the principal Alma Vanis was hired and tried to make similar changes that Mr. Orozco is now making, but was immediately fired after the same group of parents and teachers began rumors about her alleged to have had, or about her to the school community. Ms. Vanis was also fired for participating in a police investigation where a teacher was alleged to have had inappropriate relationships with female students. There is also a lawsuit against the school district and our school that is public record that will be sent with this letter. In fact, last summer, when Mr. Orozco asked the board to approve a standard employee handbook outlining exceptions, the teachers from 7th and 8th grade began telling us parents that they could no longer teach students effectively because now they have a policy for teacher-student relationships. They then began lobbying people to oust Mr. Orozco like they have the previous principals. For the first time in our school history, things are going well in our school. Our school achieved an API of 806 during the first year of Mr. Orozco. Teachers are accountable. They even arrive to work on time and are now on site for us to meet with. Teachers have clear standards on teacher-student relationships. And basically, it's Mr. Orozco is doing what he's doing for the benefit and for the best interests of the students of our school. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, board. My name is Jose Villascusa. I'm going to read to you a lawsuit, a pending lawsuit that is public, and from a former principal. On and about September 2nd, 2008, plaintiff was contacted by Detective DeVal, a sworn officer with the San Diego City Police Department, regarding a former student complaints against Jose Valencia, a teacher at Promise Charter School. The former student and her parent filed a complaint for sexual misconduct against Mr. Valencia. Detective DeVal asked plaintiff to assist with the active police investigation against Mr. Valencia. Plaintiff was initially asked to help locate the former student since she had moved with her family and could not be found. Plaintiff located the student for Detective DeVal and continued to cooperate with the investigation. On four separate occasions and dates, on October 2008, plaintiff received complaints from parents and staff concerning Mr. Valencia and inappropriate behavior with female students. The complaints alleged, among other things, that Mr. Valencia was hugging his female students too long, letting certain female students play with his hair, letting female students hang on him, sitting close to female students, using inappropriate language with his female students, and dancing too close with female students. Plaintiff reported these complaints to Detective DeVal and to the San Diego USD. On or around October 20, 2008, Peter Rivera, Charter Program Monitoring Manager, called plaintiff to discuss the status of Detective DeVal's investigation and parent complaints he received concerning Mr. Valencia's inappropriate behavior. Mr. Rogo has implemented basic changes that are not different to any other school. There are changes that were removed, and all they're doing is putting them back where they're supposed to be. Let me remind you that a principal has been fired every year until now, that the board has actually made a change for good. Most parents support the needed changes. Previously, board, even on the previous board, were even convicted felons on the board. We welcome any petition for investigation, and we ask for you to investigate this matter. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Indra Aguilar. I am a parent at Promise Charter. Most of the things that I wanted to say to you have already been said. Our name has been put through the floor. I've seen all these changes for the well-being of these kids. I am a very concerned parent because all these parents that come up to you earlier and complain about Promise Charter, most of them are not parents at Promise Charter anymore. And the ones who are there, they're complaining about things that have really no logic in my head. I have two kids. I struggle to have both of them. And my only concern for them is their education and their future because I'm not always going to be here for them. Mr. Orozco has actually taken all that into consideration, make these kids independent. I've had kids who I've met that are outside of Promise that didn't get Mr. Orozco as a principal, and they've told me that they do like the teachers that are there, but they didn't get prepared for high school, and they're having a really hard time. So all these changes that are being made are being taken into consideration because of all these testimonies from these kids that weren't prepared for high school. High school is not an easy thing.
I really think that all these changes should be looked into so that you can see for yourself what has been going on for reals and what is a lie. We get tormented at every meeting. We get bashed. They don't even let us speak. They are really rude. They intimidate all of our parents. They really don't. They don't come in peace. They don't express themselves how they should. And I am really concerned. And I really hope you do come to Promise Charter and see what is really going on. And all the changes are for the well-being of our kids. Thank you.
My name is Becky Breedlove. My address is on file. I'm here again to call into question the decision made by district staff to give Crawford Small Schools each an allocation from central funds of 1/4 of a principal when all other schools throughout the district, regardless of size or enrollment changes or achievement, have been allocated either 1/2 or 1/2 principal. Today we've just learned through an article written by Emily Alpert of the reasons for giving Crawford Small High Schools half the allocation of other small high schools and 1/4 the allocation of all other schools in the district. In the weeks ahead, we plan to question the data you may be looking at and provide evidence that might help board members come to a fairer decision with regard to this allocation and the rights of our students. It is very easy and perhaps logical for staff to compare San Diego and Kearney High to Crawford, and yet from California Department of Ed data analysis, and you'll see that on the document that I've kind of put together, most of the small schools on those campuses are not at all similar to ours. I could argue that comparing us to them and making decisions based on those comparisons makes about as much sense as comparing Lincoln and Morse to University City High and Scripps and La Jolla. I'm not going to speak today at all to the other side of this document where I've put together some, I think, kind of interesting things to consider as you look at enrollments, but I will take the few seconds that I have left to say that I have a couple of, I think, really good, positive, possible solutions to keeping the charter schools in City Heights, and I look forward to sharing those with you in an email that will come within the next couple of days. I will share personally that I don't understand the fear that many people have of having high school kids on middle school campuses. I thoroughly enjoyed being a founding member of Muir Alternative School and helping older kids understand what it meant to be around younger kids. I opened Sarah when it was a 7th through 12th grade school, and we had no problems there, but I have, don't assume that I'm suggesting one solution. Please look to my email.
Thanks, Becky.
Good evening. My name is Rob German. I'm at 2302 Montclair Street here in San Diego. I'm a parent of a child at the Benchley Weinberger Magnet School. I have a daughter who's there now in her second year. I have a son who's about a year and a half behind, and hopefully he'll be starting there when he is eligible as well. So I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm here to express my strong objection to the proposed budget cuts. Our family was drawn to Benchley Weinberger because of its communications focus and for its reputation for strong parent involvement. We have not been disappointed. My daughter is thriving there, and I am grateful to see her confidence grow as her math and language skills develop. Benchley Weinberger is recognized as a California School of Distinction and has one of the highest API ratings in the district. The students represent 56 different areas of the district and bring with them a rich diversity of cultural, ethnic, and socioeconomic backgrounds. Simply put, Benchley Weinberger is working. Now, as a parent of children in the California public school system, I've grown accustomed to the depressing reality of reduced funding for education, and yet I am appalled at the cuts currently on the table. I'm an involved parent, and I know that this school has a committed staff and an engaged parent community. These are people who have, for year in, year out, figured out a way to do more with less. But the cuts now being proposed threaten to go beyond our ability to do triage. It appears likely that we will suffer the loss of multiple instructional assistants, teachers, and deep cuts to a wide assortment of supplies. The notion that a communications magnet can do without computer lab staff, a library assistant, or equipment for the media lab, among others, is patently absurd. I am alarmed also to learn that we will likely lose our health technician, whose services will be replaced by office staff. I understand that the district is now faced with unprecedented budget cuts, but I hope that this board can see the value in protecting Benchley Weinberger and the other incredibly effective and successful magnet schools. Thank you.
Okay, Edward McTeague, Candy Nieto, Herman Corrales, Ana Gonzalez, Charles Norris.
Good evening, Board. Richard Barrera and Board members. Happy New Year to all of you. It's been a while since I've been here, but I stand before you again speaking for my program, Community-Based English Tutoring Program. I stand before you representing 22 babysitters, 7 community assistants, and 7 community college instructors who will no longer be employed if this program is eliminated. But that's not the real reason I stand before you. I stand before you to speak for approximately the 2,500 parents and community members who are learning English in schools in their communities. But even more than that, I stand before you the loss of 2,500 students who no longer will be tutored in English by those parents in their schools, one-on-one, 30 minutes a day. Baseball analogy I gave you last year is the bottom of the ninth, 3 outs and 3 strikes. But I'm not ready to give up on this program, and I hope you aren't either. I know we have tight budget decisions to make, but this is an important program. Reduce us again, but please do not get rid of this program that has been in this district for almost 13 years now. Thank you.
My name is Charles Norris, and I'm talking for Freeze Elementary. And I have a granddaughter, she goes to preschool there. And I was told that next year they're going to have a thing of more students in a classroom for kindergartners. And I don't really feel that that would be a good idea for that, because it seemed like it would be harder for the teachers to teach all these kids. Because the way that it's set up now with the elementary kids, preschool, it's enough kids in there for the teachers, plus they have so much help in there to help the students. To help the students. But the thing is, if all these kids go to a kindergarten and they behind, they'll never get caught up with what they need to get caught up with. So I really appreciate if there's any way that they can keep some staff there at Freeze Elementary to truly help the young kids that's coming along now. Because the way that it seemed to me, it seemed like we're going back in time. It's time for us to say forth, because school has been in involvement for a long time. But why take away the things that we already have for our students? Because I've talked to a lot of kids, and a lot of kids have gave up on school itself. Why? Something's not right. But now, since we have all these young kids that's coming out now, let them, or give them the opportunity to be somebody in life. Because times is changing, and education is the most important thing of life. They say, a mind is a terrible thing to waste. They don't even say that no more on TV. They used to say it every day on TV. Now, they don't even say it at all. But I appreciate if anything that you can do or anything that can be done to truly help out, so that way they can have an extra kindergarten teacher or some assistance to help these young kids coming along in school. And it's a trip trying to bring everything out that I really want to say.
You're doing a great
but
job.
The most important thing is I'm concerned about these young kids, because I want them to be successful in life. I want them to be somebody, because it's time for them to grow.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is... My name is Ana Gonzalez, and I'm a parent and chairperson of the SSC from Freeze Elementary. I'm really concerned about the budget cuts happening at Freeze next year. The one cut that worries me the most is that our magnet funds are being completely cut. Please don't cut our magnet funds. You have no idea what this program truly means to the children. You should have seen their faces, the kids this week, when I explained to them the cuts that were happening. They were completely devastated. Please reconsider cutting Freeze's magnet program. Our children's educational future depends on it. Thank you.
Uh,
Hello, my name is Herman Corrales, and I am an artist from the community and a volunteer, and my niece goes to Fries Elementary, and I just want to say that how could you guys pledge allegiance to the flag when you're depriving our American children of education? We're not honoring our educational system when we taking more programs when we need to take a step forward rather than taking two steps back. And also with the teachers, we're cutting them loose. Like, we can't do this. We need education for our country, for our future. This is making history, because without our children, they're the future. They're the ones that when we die, they're going to take over. And if we're not giving them the proper tools that they need for success, what's going to happen with our country? We need to keep on prevailing them with information and knowledge and all these programs, like the magnet program. It's the children. I talk to the children and I talk to the community because I'm a volunteer, and they don't want this to happen. I talk to the little kids. They're saying, we don't want our field trips to be gone. We don't want our arts and musics and our teachers. And they fall in love with the teachers, and then you tell them, well, we can't fund our teachers because we got no more funds. And yet there's so many other things you're funding other schools. But it's the education that we need for a better tomorrow and for our children. Because without the children, we're nothing. And we're just basically taking everything away from them. And it's not fair. Thank you. And I also want to say, I also want to thank all of you guys, and especially the teachers, because they do so much for the community and for the kids. And most of the times, they get looked over. So thank you again.
Okay, Edward McTeague, Paula Cires, Sylvie Knowles, Miriam Vergara, Yasmin Rivas, and Minerva Torres.
Good night. Buenas noches. Soy una mamá preocupada por la escuela de Fries Elementary. He visto el presupuesto del 2011-2012 y estoy decepcionada. Yo creo que ustedes tienen acciones que pueden tomar para disminuir el impacto de la educación de nuestros hijos. Fries ha sido una escuela que por muchos años ha tenido un programa magnet, donde los estudiantes toman un beneficio maravilloso a través del arte. Títeres, obra, baile, arte visual, entre muchos. Nuestros estudiantes han visitado museos, obras y baile que nunca hubieran habido poder ver sin Magnet. Magnet ha enriquecido las vidas de los niños y les ha dado una mejor vida. También estoy preocupada por el incremento en el tamaño del salón de clases. De ser de 16 niños, va a aumentar a 30. Realmente los estudiantes no recibirán la ayuda y la atención individual que se merecen, que ocupan y necesitan para tener una buena y un desarrollo en su educación. Por favor, reconsideren las peticiones de no tantos alumnos en el salón de clase. Así como yo, como madre, escogí la escuela Fries, como ustedes eligieron la mejor, yo elegí Fries.
I will interpret for the parents. Dear board members, I am a concerned parent at Fries Elementary. I have seen the 2011-2012 budget for Fries, and I am appalled. I believe there are actions you can take to lessen the impact on our students' education. Fries has been a magnet school for many years, and our students have greatly benefited from the various arts, puppetry, music, dance, visual arts, etc. Our students have visited museums, plays, dance performances that they would not be exposed to at all. This enriches their lives and helps to give them a better life. Without the field trips, teaching artists coming to Fries, and the enriched lessons my students receive, they would not be exposed, my children receive, they would not be exposed to these rich cultural experiences. I am also concerned about the increase in K-3 class size from 16-1 to 30-1. I feel students will not receive the individual attention to the education each child needs, and many will get lost in the sheer numbers of students in the classroom. Please reconsider taking our magnet funding away. Please consider reconsider raising the class size in smaller amounts over the next few years. The future of our children depend on it.
Thanks. What's your name? I'm sorry.
Her name is Paula Ceres.
Hola, buenas tardes, miembros de la mesa directiva. Mi nombre es Yasmin Rivas.
Soy una mamá de niños de Freeze. Estoy muy preocupada por los recortes que quieren hacer de profesores y el programa Magnet, ya que esto perjudicará a todos los niños. Y recuerden que la educación que ellos puedan tener hoy será muy importante en sus vidas, porque los niños son el futuro del mañana. Gracias a todos.
Good afternoon, board members. My name is Jasmine Rivas. I am a mother with children at Freeze. I am very worried about the budget cuts that you want to do, including through the Magnet program, since this will affect the children in a bad way. And remember that the education that they can have today will be very important in their lives, because children are the future for tomorrow. Thank you all.
Good evening, board members. My name is Miriam Vergara. I am a parent of a second grader at Freeze Elementary School. And as a parent, I'm concerned with the massive budget cuts that will be imposed at our school site. And these cuts, I believe, are threatening the ability for our teachers to provide quality educational programs for our children. If it is truly a priority to educate our children, why have less funding, which will equal to less teachers? How will having 30 plus kids in a classroom benefit them when we have kids that will fall behind because they are struggling to learn the English language because we don't have enough funds to have an English learner coordinator or translator or an English support teacher? We have kids with learning disabilities and special education needs ranging from moderate to severe, and our funds will not allow us to have enough special ed assistants or special ed technicians. How will one teacher with 30 students be able to work with our children to help them accomplish our mission statement that indicates graduate with the skills, motivation, curiosity, and resilience needed to succeed in their choice of college and career in order to lead and participate in the society of tomorrow? Is this really quality and excellence in education? Another concern I have is possibly not having enough funding to have a nurse or health technician at our site. I'm concerned about this because I have an asthmatic child, and I know that there's other parents that have diabetic kids or have another chronic illness, and I believe it's important to have someone there because you never know when your child is going to have an asthma attack. We need the appropriate care and certified professionals to take care of our children. Please reconsider the budget allocated for Freeze Elementary. Thanks for your time.
Hi, my name is Minerva Torres, and I'm here representing Freeze Elementary. I'm here as a mother who is very concerned with all the budget cuts that are being made in our schools. I'm very worried how these budget cuts are going to affect my children, our children in our Freeze Elementary School. I mean, I see how they are struggling right now. I could just imagine how it's going to be worse with 30 children in a kindergarten classroom. I believe that our children will have a hard time learning in a class size with that number of children. I don't like that they are also going to take the Magnet program away from our school. These programs help the children interact with others and work as a group. They are also learning special skills that might help them in their future. Please help our children get the education that they need, and don't take that from them. They need these programs. Thank you.
Good evening, board members, Mr. President Ibarra, Mr. Belkoba, superintendent, and all others. My name is Sophie Knowles. I live at 7944 Wayland Drive, San Diego, California, in the San Carlos community. I'm here tonight only to offer some information that we were made aware of last week by our manager in the Enrollment Options Office. We have each met one-on-one with our manager, and out of all the staff in our department, everyone has been cut except for one bilingual clerk and one secretary. Now, we process over 15,000 Choice Magnet VEEP, No Child Left Behind applications a year. We also process over 5,000 inter-district attendance permits, half, I believe, which are incoming students to our district that we actually get money from these students coming in from other districts. Now, I'm just putting the board on alert because this has been already said it's going to happen. Nothing's going to happen until you vote upon it. So I thought I would make you aware of what has been proposed. We have invited our director of curriculum to several staff meetings so he could come and see the office, see what we do, see what important work we do for this district. It only takes 200 students to bring in 200 students from other districts to pay for our entire department. And I know that Mr. Phil Stover last year advocated for our department because we do a lot of work for our magnet schools, for our No Child Left Behind, for our parents, for the community, for students. And I just want everyone to be aware that what's being proposed is that the one clerk input all the applications, and then we close the office 3 or 4 days a week, whatever it takes, and that's not reality. And it's such an asset for this district. I would hate to see it happen. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks,
good night.
Sylvia. All right. Thanks for everybody for staying till the end of the meeting, and that concludes our meeting tonight. Thank you very much.